Hello and welcome to Battleground 2014. We are in Maharashtra's capital Mumbai to discuss the election scene in this crucial state. With 7 crore voters or more and 48 seats being contributed to the Lok Sabha, Maharashtra is second only to UP in terms of its political weight in Indian Parliament. Maharashtra has been unkind to the BJP in 2004 and 2009, pouring cold water over its political ambitions. Will the BJP be lucky this time around? How will the Congress and the NCP fare in this state? They suffer from double incumbency, 15 years of ruling Maharashtra and 10 years of being part of the United Progressive Alliance government at Delhi. And what about the Shiv Sena? It enters into Lok Sabha elections for the first time after the demise of Balasaheb Thackeray. How will it fare? To answer all these questions and more, I have with me a very distinguished panel of experts. We have with us my old friend Kumar Ketkar, an eminent journalist, former editor of Divya Marathi, editor of Lok Satta, Maharashtra Times and Economic Times. He knows the state well. And we have with us Professor Uttara Sahasrabuddhe, professor of political science at University of Mumbai. And another eminent journalist, Pratap Thorat. He writes both on the web and in print and writes with incisiveness about the politics and economics of Maharashtra. I welcome all of you to this discussion. Kumar, let me begin with you. Is it the multi-cornered contests in Maharashtra, or is it local factors which have made this election very unpredictable in the state?
Actually, not very unpredictable, because the anti-incumbency is not only anti-incumbency, but also because of NCP Congress unstable alliance and the allegations of corruption and the overall indifference of the ruling government towards people and towards their issues have created an atmosphere of complete anti-Congress, anti-NCP. And therefore, despite the fact that BJP and Shiv Sena have not put their house in order, and Shiv Sena is actually split, and in spite of all these problems with the BJP, Shiv Sena, Saffron Alliance, they are going to get much more seats because of the strong anti-incumbency, anti-Congress, anti-NCP alliance.
Okay. Professor Sahasrabuddhe, how big a challenge are these elections to the political future of Chief Minister Prithviraj Chauhan?
Oh, it could be a very huge challenge for him to face, because he came back into the state to lead the state at a time when allegations of corruptions were rampant against not only the ministers but also the Chief Minister of Maharashtra state. He has tried to do a certain things, but much of his career, much of his tenure as Chief Minister has been, we can talk about him as a Chief Minister who has rather not taken any decisions, and not somebody who has taken a decision against corruption or against
He was more or less steadying the ship.
He was trying to do that. In fact, you know, in many ways, inaction on his part was one way of preventing corruption on the part of certain ministers. But I think he's going to face a tough challenge, because he'll be a poor man facing the next Vidhan Sabha State Assembly elections under, most probably under his stewardship. Congress will be facing it. And if the BJP does well, the NDA Alliance does well in this in the state during the Lok Sabha elections, I think his party will be at the receiving end.
Okay. Pratap, of the two anti-incumbencies that the Congress NCP Alliance faces, one in the state and one because of the centre, which one is going to cost them more votes?
Of course, the centre. Centre, this is one thing. Second thing is, Mr. Prithviraj Chauhan didn't care to muster support of local congressmen because he's so much in good books of Mrs. Sonia Gandhi. He just didn't care. So everybody was against him here. And he was busy only with his officers, not caring for all that. The other thing is, the other day, he made a statement against Ashok Chauhan. He's worried that if Ashok Chauhan is revived, he said that only the Congress Election Committee gave him ticket, he was not for that. So this type of thing. So that even on the eve of the election, this game of one-upmanship in the Congress is going on. Okay. NCP is a divided house. Sharad Pawar's authority over his own party, not only the state, but only on his own party has eroded. Okay. That is the major difference here.
Okay. Kumar, talking of the government's inaction, 2 months ago there was a hailstorm in Marathwada and Vidarbha region. 1.6 million hectares of crop was affected. And yet the government did nothing. Farmer suicides, which had sort of taken a back seat, once again became the focus of the media, because about 40 farmers committed suicide in this period. So there was inaction, And that inaction was compounded by saying that the election code of conduct has now come into force and we can do nothing. So how much is that going to affect voting pattern in this region?
Actually, if you see 1.5 years ago, the same region where the hailstorm came was suffering under drought, very severe drought.
Yeah.
Now, after the drought, even before those grievances have been settled, came the hailstorm.
Okay.
So even if government has done something which it claims it has, it has come very late because the drought conditions were still there, and now suddenly comes the hailstorm. You can attribute it to climate change, but the fact is that farmers are not bothered from where it came because of climate change or whatever. They are not getting the relief. And what is the main problem with the Congress and NCP government is insensitivity towards the people, total disconnect with the people.
But insensitivity was there during the drought also. I remember
yes.
Ajit Pawar saying
yeah.
that does he need to urinate
exactly.
in the dams to
exactly.
supply water?
Yeah, that insensitivity and disconnect with the people and the farmers, who naturally form 60%, are actually the problems with the Congress and the NCP. That insensitivity, disconnect will perhaps cause them the major setback.
Okay. Let's talk about urbanization, which is also a big issue here, because Maharashtra has become the third most urbanized state after Kerala and Tamil Nadu. But this urbanization is taking place by converting agricultural land to so-called new urban cities. Now, the larger farmers, I am told, they benefit from it because they've got the land to sell. But then in this process of urbanization, which is being celebrated, the small farmers and the landless laborers, they get completely marginalized and they have no social safety net. Now, is that a big issue in this election or is it not?
It's going to be a big issue because if you look at the urbanization built in Maharashtra, it is concentrated in certain areas.
Yeah.
Maybe Mumbai Thane is an area where it is taking place at a rate which is amazing. You can go to Pune, you can go to Nashik, the so-called golden triangle of the state. But as far as the problem of urbanization is concerned, not only what you said is true, that the marginal farmers and smaller farmers will be further marginalized in the process. There's another problem to the entire process. If this marginalized farmer community is migrating to the urban centers in order to search for certain jobs, they are going to face more severe problems in the urban centers because they also remain at the periphery of the urban centers in that
because they're unskilled.
They may not be able to get secure jobs in the urban centers, and the lack of education on their part as well as lack of skills will cause them further because poverty is extremely bad in the urban areas as compared to the rural areas.
Pratap, how serious is this problem of urbanization? Do you want to add something to it?
Yeah, definitely. It's a very serious problem. Most of the leaders of Maharashtra, they come from the sugar belt. And they were very familiar with the terms like sugar recovery, which was 9, 10, 11%, 13%. Now, or tonnage per acre of the sugar cane. But nowadays, they are, or their next generation, they are concerned, they know more, they are better versed with FSI. This is urbanization.
So the sugar barons have become real estate agents?
Yeah, real estate agents. And some of them own the whole cities, entire cities.
Yeah.
They are owners of the cities. This has become, next generation understand FSI more than sugar recovery. And the Maharashtra is premier industrial state. There is no manufacturing growth, no employment growth. Poverty has not declined to a good extent, and people are unconcerned. The sugar cooperatives, they were doing too well, but sugar cooperatives, the third generation of sugar lords, they are going in for private industries. And of course, FSI is their obsession.
Okay. Kumar, of the 17 seats the Congress won in 2009, 7 were urban seats. Do you think the urban population will vote differently this time, and what are the reasons for that difference?
Well, actually, urban population in Maharashtra, particularly Mumbai and Thane, last time they won good seats in Mumbai, all 6 seats in Mumbai. But the urban population now is quite different than urban population even 5 years ago.
Okay.
You know, the migrants come from the drought-prone Marathwada, the migrant comes from Bihar and UP, the migrants come from South, and all this together creates a completely chaotic atmosphere. Once upon a time, Mumbai was known for, because of these migrants, a cosmopolitan culture city. Today that cosmopolitanism has disappeared completely. What has happened now is the lumpens dominating the city. How lumpens will vote is extremely unclear, and therefore I may be surprised if Congress gets the same number of seats, which is 6 last time, because the discontent has grown across the border, across all cities, not only Mumbai, but Mumbai, Thane, Pune, Nasik, everywhere. So the ruling alliance is likely to get a beating, even in urban centre.
Let's talk about something different. Let's talk about dynastic politics. Now, I'm told in 50% of the seats, of the 48 seats, in 24 seats in Maharashtra, there's at least one person from a political dynasty contesting. Are people upset with the dynastic culture, and what are the new dynastic science like? Pratap says they're bothered about FSI, but they're also brash. They see their participation in politics as an entitlement. So do people see this, and do they resent it?
Absolutely. At least the urban middle class voter, especially the middle class voter, looks at it as a great problem. Dynastic politics is something that is absolutely resented by the middle class voters, at least. However, I really have a doubt how far the voters in the rural areas in Maharashtra, let's take for example the constituencies of somebody like Vilasrao Deshmukh, perhaps, you know, where his son is all likely to win, perhaps. You know, so there is a urban-rural divide, I would say, on this particular count, dynastic politics as such. The brashness of the next generations of politicians coming from the same dynasty may not be as equally felt by the rural voters, who look at them as some sort of a caretakers, rather than what they appear in the urban centers like Mumbai. Okay. However, I may want to add one small point to this. So far, at least about 10 years back, it was said that Congress has a monopoly over dynastic politics. Today, if you look at various political parties in Maharashtra, in addition to Congress and NCP, you have Shiv Sena, you have MNS, you also have parties like BJP, where the second generation of people is coming out, and even in a party like BJP, which boasts of being a cadre-based political party, they have second generation, but like Pramod Mahajan's daughter is contesting, Gopinath Munde's daughter is already a MLA in the state, the leader of the opposition in state assembly, Eknath Khadse's daughter-in-law is contesting. So even the BJP is being carried away in this entire trend of dynastic politics.
Pratap, how tough will this election be for the NCP in terms of retaining its clout at the centre?
NCP's clout is on a decline for sure.
Yeah.
Mr. Sharad Pawar, who was in the parliament or legislature for last 47 years, he contested 14 elections and won all the 14 elections. And now he cannot control his own party men. They rebelled against Sharad Pawar, they fought against Narayan Rane in Konkan. Yeah. It was a
team. So is it in desperation that he's asking his state leaders, people who are in the legislative assembly, to contest Lok Sabha elections?
No, the one thing is that his only agenda in this election was getting his daughter elected, point number one. Point number two is defeating Gopinath Munde, number two, and defeating Raju Shetty from Hatkanagle, that farmers leader. Because Raju Shetty and Munde took this battle to his own constituency, Pawar's constituency. They were very aggressive, and Pawar just cannot tolerate that. So that was his agenda, Pawar. But Pawar, that beyond that agenda, he is finding it very difficult to control his own party, and he wanted to send all these leaders or the second rank of the NCP to parliament because he wants to clear the decks for his own daughter's coronation, one thing, or Ajit Pawar Singh. And there is a lot of fight also within the family also, but he is an excellent crisis manager, so he has kept it under a tight lid.
Okay, all right, we need to take a break at this point. We'll be back again with this interesting discussion in a bit. Don't go away. Welcome back. We're discussing the election scene in Maharashtra. Kumar, let me ask you a more general question. Given the ammunition that the opposition has against the NCP Congress combined in the state and at the centre, have they been able to make an effective use of the anti-incumbency sentiment?
Absolutely not. Because the BJP Sena itself is a house divided. And house divided so much that they don't know what they are doing, what they are campaigning for. They have no vision, they have no agenda, they have no program. They were only banking on the performance of the Congress and the NCP, which has been miserable. But their own vision of Maharashtra, what they will do, there was nothing in the past and nothing now. So the question is, how BJP Sena will actually be able to, if the given atmosphere is such that they could have got something like 40 plus seats, but they are stuck at something like 25, 26 perhaps, is because they don't have any program. And their BJP is divided between Gadkari and Munde. Shiv Sena is divided between Raj and Uddhav, though MNS is started. So I think BJP and Sena cannot really give any hope for the people
But just because people are fed up with the present government, they might vote for them.
So, Professor Sastribude, would you say there's an anti-incumbency wave in Maharashtra, or is there a Modi wave in Maharashtra?
Difficult to see the Modi wave in Maharashtra, although in some urban centers there's definitely so. I mean, if you see some hysterics around, especially in cities like Mumbai, if you go to some of the western suburbs in Mumbai, you probably see that Modi wave. But anti-incumbency is more prominent, I would agree with Mr. Yeah. Ketkar, far more prominent in that yeah. case.
Pratap, Kumar talked about the vertical divide between Nitin Gadkari and Gopinath Munde.
Yeah.
But people also say that what brings them together is Modi. Modi is the glue that brings the two factions together. Mm-hmm. Does it bring them together, or is that going to impact BJP's prospects?
It is a temporary arrangement. Because the real fight is for the assembly elections. Mr. Pawar is interested only in the assembly election, not in this Lok Sabha election. Yeah. Mr. Munde, he wants to become Chief Minister of Maharashtra on the basis of Modi's performance, and therefore he is more interested in the assembly poll. That is why this poll is just a pilot reading for them.
Assembly election is in October this year.
Yeah, by the year end.
So what you are suggesting is that Gopinath Munde is playing for the assembly while Gadkari is playing for the center, or?
Gadkari is playing for the center. That is true, and the fight will again. It will be revived, no?
Yeah.
To arrest Munde from that thing, his activities. Yeah. This is the thing. Mr. Pawar, of course, he is interested because he wanted to send most of his secondary leadership to Delhi. That is not possible, it seems now.
Yeah.
And the other thing is, how will he tackle the fight between the two cousins, Supriya and Ajit? How to make Supriya to get that advantage? That is his problem. How he will manage? He is an excellent crisis manager. He will do that.
Okay.
But can I add just one point? Please. Actually, everybody is realizing now, it's no more a secret, that BJP itself, in BJP, the top leadership, including Gadkari, I can name him, including Gadkari, perhaps even Munde, they are not happy with Modi's leadership.
So, in fact, my question was going to you. The question was that, has the projection of one face, that is the face of Narendra Modi, has it gone to the advantage of BJP, or has it hobbled it because the local leaders feel that they've been ignored and they're being treated casually?
Well, it is advantage to an extent that they have been able to create a frenzy among the mass. And it's a frenzy, it's not support. I have known what support means. I have seen Indira Gandhi's elections, I have seen Janata Party election, I have seen Rajiv Gandhi. Support and frenzy are two different. What we are witnessing is frenzy. Now, this BJP leadership feels, including some members of the RSS, I cannot name them here in channel, but they are terribly worried, terribly apprehensive that Modi is becoming much, much larger than life, and therefore their actual leadership, their actual role is going to be marginalized.
No, my question was limited to the elections here.
Yeah, so
Modi's projection is helps the BJP, but is also counterproductive.
Yeah, it helps and is also counterproductive. Counterproductive because some of the karyakartas, some of the shakha pramukhs in RSS as well as Shiv Sena. Shiv Sena is known for being anti-Modi. Shiv Sena publicly had demanded that we don't want Modi, we want Sushma Swaraj. In fact, I will not be revealing a secret. If Balasaheb Thackeray was alive, he would not have endorsed Narendra Modi's prime ministership the way it is being endorsed now. He had already said just before his death, Sushma Swaraj would be the best prime minister. That he would have continued because Shiv Sena Pramukh Balasaheb Thackeray would not tolerate two Hindutva stalwarts to be at the top. He himself considered the top.
Okay. Professor Sastribude, the absence of Bal Thackeray, how important is it for the alliance? Because with Bal Thackeray out of the scene and given Uddhav Thackeray's mild, maybe effective, but mild manner of functioning, do you think BJP has got an upper hand in the alliance, and has it been able to extract any advantages in the alliance because of that?
Let's look at it this way. In the Lok Sabha elections, the BJP has always had an upper hand. They have been able to extract more seats from the Shiv Sena.
Yeah.
However, when it comes to the assembly elections, it remains to be seen how Shiv Sena will face it in the absence of Balasaheb Thackeray in coming October or November, whenever the elections take place. But definitely, the absence of Balasaheb Thackeray will be affecting adversely, as far as the Shiv Sena is concerned. There is chaos within the ranks. They don't know. I mean, there have been people going from Shiv Sena to MNS and back, and that process has taken place for some time. And this chaos and this some kind of confusion after Balasaheb Thackeray will actually affect Shiv Sena adversely in this election.
Let me ask you something else. This bringing in of Raju Shetty, Swabhimani Shetkari Sangatna, Ramdas Athawale's Republican Party, and this other party, Rashtriya Samaj Paksha, Will it help the BJP and will it help it across the state, only in some regions and or across castes?
Forget across the state, it will help them if at all, only in very small pockets. Raju Shetty was the well-known enemy of the BJP.
Yeah.
He used to call it Bharat Jalao Party.
Yeah.
So, Raju Shetty's sudden alliance with BJP does not help BJP, does not help him. It can be, actually it can put him in a problem.
Yeah.
So, all these alliances, like Vinayak Mete joining there, Swami Shetkari joining there,
yeah.
I don't think BJP is going to benefit. Perhaps they will be benefiting on the anti-incumbency wave with the help of BJP.
Okay. Talking once again about the BJP Shiv Sena alliance, there have been a lot of defections.
Yes.
You said between MNS and Shiv Sena, but there have been defections away from Shiv Sena to parties which don't share their ideology, to NCP
Absolutely.
For example.
Yes, yes.
And majority of the defections are actually to not to MNS but to other parties.
Yes, yes.
Why is that? Because ideologically, if you are unhappy with Uddhav Thackeray, you should go to a ideologically similar party, that is Raj Thackeray's Maharashtra Nav Nirman Sena.
Or BJP even. They don't go to BJP also.
They don't go to BJP.
Why?
But I doubt very much because I doubt very much whether these people who are leaving Shiv Sena are swayed by ideology or by something else. They, many of them,
what
in fact,
what is that something else?
That something else is a political culture of certain party.
Yeah.
If you look at the way they have gone, many of them have actually gone to the NCP. And if you look at the parallels between the political culture of NCP and Shiv Sena in the state, Gundaism, politics of violence, then, you know, some kind of holding people to ransom. This entire thing probably attracts, and it's not just Shiv Sena, like Anand Paranjpe leaving Shiv Sena and going to NCP. There have been the other way around defections as well. Some NCP local people leaving the NCP and coming to Shiv Sena. So this, I think, is the matching of some political culture at the grassroots level that has caused many of them to leave Shiv Sena, Chagan Bhujbal included, and go to NCP in fact.
It is an alliance of musclemen from rural area with musclemen of urban area.
Okay, but Prasad, do you agree with this, or do you think people are leaving because they see a better political future in other parties rather than with Shiv Sena?
No political, they are not bought the party. Sharad Pawar is just affecting this matter. On the eve of the election, he is taking Uddhav Thackeray's most trusted lieutenant Raju Narvekar to his fold and giving me ticket and making the sitting Shiv Sena MLA to give his seat to Raju Narvekar. He is managing that. And that is why it is happening. No, they don't see any political preacher, because Mr. Pawar never got into double digits so far as his performance in Lok Sabha is concerned. So, and he is not expected to do that even this thing. So, how will it? There is no political future, but he is managing that.
Okay. Kumar, in the context of all this, how crucial are these elections for Uddhav Thackeray? You knew his father very well.
Yeah, yeah.
But what about the political future of Uddhav Thackeray? Will Shiv Sena get completely marginalized in these elections?
No. Shiv Sena will not get marginalized. In fact, it will be a shot in the arm for Uddhav, because he is winning in spite of himself.
Oh.
I mean, Shiv Sena will be winning whatever seats they win because of the anti-incumbency, anti-Congress, anti-NCP wave.
Yeah.
And it will be considered as if it is Uddhav Thackeray's victory, because MNS is not likely to get many seats. So, vis-a-vis Raj, Uddhav will win. Vis-a-vis Congress and NCP, Uddhav will win. So, Uddhav will be considered as a winner in spite of him. And therefore, it will be shot in the arm for the assembly election. But as Uttaraviri correctly said, at that time, the scenario will be totally different.
Yeah. But if it's advantage Uddhav all the way this time around, for a variety of reasons, his neglect of Modi would be seen as something which was correct historically. Then in retrospect, people say he was all right, and it was Raj Thackeray who was wrong.
That could be possible, and we yet have to see, because I keep having this wishful thinking that if the BJP does not cross about, say, 180 seats in the centre, it's very difficult for Modi to become the Prime Minister. They have been projecting him as he very rightly pointed out that to create that hysterics and to create the frenzy.
Yeah.
But there will be allies who are likely to be attracted to the BJP, who may not want to support the BJP if Modi is the leader of the party.
Okay.
And in that case, Uddhav will stand vindicated
at
the end of the elections.
Okay. Let's talk about Raj Thackeray for a bit. MNS candidates have traditionally split the saffron or Hindutva votes and helped the Congress.
Yeah.
Would the same thing happen this time around also, or are there other factors at play?
That is his main agenda. Raj Thackeray's main agenda is that. Otherwise, he could have got some good image, or some good, he would have performed better, like say Arvind Kejriwal, what he did in Delhi. But he is not doing that. He is not talking of contesting all the 288 assembly seats this time. Otherwise, Raj Hoda just overtaken Uddhav. He's on that. He's on because there are a lot of doubts about his hesitations also. Again, the toll hesitations. He compromises. He compromises, and that is why he has not. His image has gone down to a great extent.
Because many of his critics say that he is a Congress team B. But because every time he has, the fact is, if Raj was not there in 2009 election, then obviously Congress would have gone at that time.
But if you were
Raj, perhaps has influenced five Lok Sabha seats in Mumbai and has influenced something like 40 Vidhan Sabha seats.
Definitely.
Kumar, if let me just ask you a question. If you can see this, surely Raj Thackeray can also see this.
Yeah.
So his political future is not in being the team B of Congress, but being something else. So why does he consciously take this step which doesn't really help?
Well, I think it was Shakespeare who said that hatred is stronger sentiment than love. And in this case, Raj's hatred for Uddhav is so strong that his first agenda is to decimate Uddhav.
Okay.
And in that process, he is ready to take support of the Congress.
I'm sorry I interrupted you. You were saying something.
No. He said it. Kumara said it.
Yeah. If I may just add one thing. If you see the 10 candidates he has fielded in this election, 8 of them are against Shiv Sena.
Yeah.
You know, so that makes it absolutely clear what is his agenda, in fact.
He sweated only for Uddhav, no. He had disannounced that he will fight only Shiv Sena candidate.
Okay. Yes.
And he is supporting Modi, not BJP.
Okay.
That is strange ideology in delay.
Okay.
But in Pune, he is contesting against the BJP candidate.
Yes. Okay.
He has got his own arrangements, his own arrangement with Pratap Rao Kadam of the Congress.
Okay.
That is why he is
How do you see the prospects of the Aam Aadmi Party in this election?
Well, Aam Aadmi Party has a good support of good people, but it doesn't make mark on the electoral scene.
Uttara?
It'll be very difficult to see them getting even one seat, you know, even despite the fact that somebody like stalwart like Medha Patkar is contesting. I really don't know.
Uttara, do you agree?
The other thing is Aam Aadmi Party may get good number of votes in Marathwada region where Congress has done badly.
Yeah.
So that Muslim vote between 15% to 25% is in Marathwada region, old Nizam state. So they might prefer Aam Aadmi, but that will not help them to win any seat.
Okay.
That is the thing.
Okay. So thank you very much.
Yeah.
That's all we have for you today. Have a free election and a fair election, and do go and vote. We'll be back again next week from another city, another state. Till then, goodbye and thanks for watching.